Bueno, pues, bueno. Muy buenas tardes a todos. Hoy tenemos el gusto de tener una vez más con nosotros al profesor Efim Zelmanov, de la Universidad de San Diego, de California, en San Diego, medallista Fields del 94, que bueno, nos va a hablar parte de sus grandes contribuciones al álgebra. Ha hecho muchas grandes contribuciones y varias de ellas, de las más fundamentales, han sido precisamente en este tema del que nos va a hablar hoy. Es realmente un gran honor y un placer tener con nosotros al profesor Zelmanov una vez más.
Thank you. So I was instructed mostly to have graduate students in mind, and probably the majority here are graduate students. I don't know if you are familiar with the concept of Lie algebras and Lie groups, and the theory of the Lie theory. Classification of Lie algebras and Lie groups was one of the high point of mathematics of the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century. Classification of finite dimensional simple Lie algebras over, say, complex numbers was done mostly by Killing and finished by Cartan. And well, this is a very well developed theory. I won't talk about it. In the 1960s, people started to look at infinite dimensional Lie algebras. And so we will consider infinite dimensional Lie algebras that are graded by integers. It means that L is a sum of subspaces indexed by integers, and whenever you multiply elements from two subspaces, their degrees add. You may ask why do we want to concentrate on this, on graded algebras? Later I will consider the most important examples. You know, we follow examples. And these examples happen to be Z-graded. So apparently this is a natural condition. And if we want to study infinite dimensional algebras, we can start with those that grow not too fast. Such that dimensions of these subspaces grow not too fast. It's like with manifolds. The most interesting manifolds are low-dimensional manifolds. So we will be especially interested in Lie algebras of polynomial growth, which means that there exists a polynomial bound for all these dimensions. Now, the degree of these polynomials can be captured by the formula at the beginning of the page. It's called Gelfand-Kirilov dimension of this algebra. You know, if you, Gelfand and Kirilov also introduced it in the 60s, they needed to show that two infinite dimensional algebras are not isomorphic. So they needed some invariant of an infinite dimensional algebra. If you have two finite groups, you can look at least at their orders, and if orders are not equal, then they are not isomorphic. We say countably dimensional algebras, the trick won't work, but you can compare how fast they grow. And that's an invariant. We will also, if you want classification, then of course we should focus on graded simple algebras. We don't demand that these algebras are simple. They are allowed to contain non-trivial ideals, but they are not allowed to contain non-trivial graded ideals. Now let's consider, talk about examples. Yes? Well, ultimately that will be the case. In all examples that is the case. So, yeah. So the first example. Let G be a finite dimensional simple Lie algebra, and we consider Laurent polynomials over it. Then the degree is a degree with respect to T. And all these homogeneous subspaces have the same dimension, the dimension of G. So the growth is linear. If G was simple, then this algebra is graded simple. It is not simple, but graded simple. in Gelfand-Kirillov dimension is equal to 1 because the growth is linear. Another, well, this example can be twisted a little bit. The Lie algebra itself could be graded by a finite cyclic group, and we consider only subspaces whose degrees agree. That's called twisted version of the example one. In all these algebras, or some very close algebras, were introduced independently by Katz and Moody, the fine Katz-Moody algebras in the 60s. The purpose, at least of Katz, was to classify simple graded Lie algebras of polynomial growth. And that was obviously one of the basic examples. Later, a fine Katz-Moody algebras conquered mathematics and many areas of theoretical physics, because that was the right time for them to be introduced, and they had so many connections. Another examples. Now, all these infinite dimensional algebras were known. For example, examples 2, 3, 4, 5 were introduced by Elie Cartan in differential geometry. Let us consider polynomials in n variables, ordinary polynomials, and let's consider their derivations. Some students may not know what is a derivation of an abstract algebra. It's very simple. It's a linear transformation of this algebra which satisfies the product rule. So the derivative of a product is equal to the derivative of the left factor times right factor plus left factor times the derivative of the right factor, that's it. And every derivation of polynomials can be written in this way, where these are just partial derivatives. This algebra is graded. We say that degrees of all variables are equal to 1, degrees of all partial derivations are equal to negative 1, that's it. So it has these gradings. All negative components to the left of negative 1 are equal to 0, and Gelfand-Kirillov dimension is equal to n. So it has polynomial growth. That is the first algebra in the Cartan type. It has interesting subalgebras, which keep certain differential forms invariant. I don't want to go into details. Special, Hamiltonian, and compact subalgebras. There is another algebra of the type that we have just discussed. Derivations of the algebra of Laurent polynomials in one variable. Again, degree is determined by the power of t. You may ask, before we considered derivations of polynomial algebras, and now we consider Laurent polynomials. Why couldn't we consider Laurent polynomials in several variables? Because in that case, dimensions of homogeneous components are infinite if you allow two Laurent variables. But if you have only one, then it is fine, and actually equal to one. So in 67, Katz wanted to classify all these algebras, and he proved that under a certain technical assumption, every graded simple Lie algebra of polynomial growth is isomorphic to an algebra of one of the previous examples. A fine Laurent polynomials over finite dimensional simple algebra, twisted version, or Cartan type, or Virasoro. This algebra, by the way, is called Virasoro. Some central extension of it is called Virasoro, so this is called Fentelis Virasoro algebra. They were first mentioned by Richard Bloch, then by Gelfand and his co-authors. They were mentioned many times. And finally, the physicist Virasoro mentioned them. And so it became known as Virasoro algebra. That's a counterexample to a rule of Arnold, that every concept is named after the second person. who introduced it. But the technical assumption of Katz ruled out the Virasoro. So he conjectured that if you drop that assumption, then the only new example will be the Virasoro algebra. So, and it was proved in 91 by Olivier Mathieu, extremely complicated proof. So now we can say that all graded simple algebras of polynomial growth are examples 1-6. And the funny thing is that all Lie infinite dimensional Lie algebras that proved to be important outside of algebra found their place in this classification. Okay, one can generalize it, say instead of algebras graded by integers, you can index subspaces by n tuples of integers, then it is graded by this free abelian group. And, largely this classification theory is unfinished. Iohara and Mathieu only classified the case when dimensions of all homogeneous components are equal to 1. Very special case. But even for Lie algebras, I don't know many people, or any people, who read the paper. Now let us talk about superalgebras. Well, a superalgebra is just an algebra which is graded by the cyclic group of order 2. So it is a sum of two subspaces. One is called even, another one is called odd. When you multiply two even elements, the product is even. When you multiply an even element times odd element, the product is odd. When you multiply two odd elements, the product is even. That's it, period. Let's consider at least two examples. You can consider matrices of size m plus n and divide it into blocks. Then block diagonal matrices are even. Off diagonal matrices are odd. So it's a superalgebra. Another example. Let's consider the Grassmann or exterior algebra. It is generated by this Grassmann or exterior variables. Their squares are equal to zero and they anti-commute. So it is easy to show that the basis consists of ordered products. If the length of the product is even, we say that that element is even. If the length is odd, then it is odd. So it's also a superalgebra. In fact, this concept was introduced in the 60s in algebraic topology. And the theory developed then in the 70s some connections to supersymmetry were found, and modest mathematicians called them just graded algebras. Then connections to supersymmetry were found, so they became superalgebras, much more marketable name. It does not mean that they are superior to other algebras. It means connections to supersymmetry, a beautiful theory that is not getting any confirmation on the supercollider. Okay, now, given an arbitrary superalgebra, we can consider its so-called Grassmann envelope. Here it is. We consider a tensor product with Grassmann algebra, and then, take this subalgebra. It's called Grassmann envelope. And this concept was probably introduced by Berezin. Now let V be a variety of algebras. A variety of algebras is a class of algebras defined by identities. For example, you could consider the variety of all commutative algebras. They are defined by commutativity. It's a variety. Or associative and commutative, or two identities. Lie algebras is a variety. So take any variety of algebras, and we say that A is a V superalgebra, or superalgebra that corresponds to that variety, if and only if the Grassmann envelope lies in that variety. In that way, choose your favorite variety and you have a corresponding superalgebra. In particular, we can talk about Lie superalgebras. The final classification of finite dimensional simple Lie superalgebras of a field of complex numbers. Well, I don't know if there are graduate students here who do algebra. Arnold used to say that you can immediately recognize an algebraist. They start their talk with, let F be an algebraically closed field of zero characteristic. So please notice, I said complex numbers. So he introduced classification, he finished the classification. Many types were introduced by physicists in the process, and he proved that there is nothing else. Now, since the purpose of my talk is infinite dimensional algebra, in 70s, 80s, the Virasoro algebra proved to be so important in various physical models that simultaneously many physicists came to the following idea. Why don't we consider some superextension of the Virasoro algebra? What does superextension mean? Some Lie super algebra which contains the Virasoro algebra in the even part, and which would be somehow close to it, and maybe we could introduce that super algebra to physical models and get something interesting. So the first such super algebras were introduced by Nevier, Schwarz, Ramon, Seiberg, many others. And they became known as super conformal algebra. So what is it? It's a Lie super algebra. It contains the Virasoro in the even part. And physicists were not too bothered by general axiomatic framework. They just introduced examples and studied them. Van Katz and Van Belleur made the following observation, that if you analyze all known superconformal algebras, they have the following common properties. They are all Z-graded, and they contain the Virasoro algebra as a graded subalgebra. And dimensions, they're all graded simple, and dimensions of all homogeneous components are uniformly bounded from above. So they said, why don't we formally define superconformal algebras by these properties, and start the search of all superconformal algebras. Maybe we'll find something else. Again, let's consider some examples. If you consider Laurent polynomials over a finite dimensional simple Lie super algebra, it is graded simple. Dimensions of all components are actually equal, but it doesn't contain the Virasoro subalgebra. So it's not superconformal. Now let us construct analogs of Cartan type algebras. What is the analog of polynomial algebra? We consider one even. You could say that this is simultaneously an analog of Cartan type algebra and of Virasoro. We have one even variable, only one, and it is Laurent. So T and T inverse, and finitely many Grassmann variables. What are these Grassmann variables? So practically we consider the tensor product of the algebra of Laurent polynomials and Grassmann algebra. You know, there is super analysis. It deals with not only with ordinary even variables, but also with Grassmann variables. You can consider partial derivations with respect to them. So we consider all super derivations of this algebra. It's kind of analog of polynomials. They all look this way. You can partial derivative with respect to the even variable or odd variables. And this algebra is fine. It is graded by the degrees of T, and all homogeneous components are finite dimensional. In fact, they have the same dimension. You may ask, how come that with even variables they were infinite dimensional and now they're finite dimensional? It's because these are Grassmann variables. The square of each of them is equal to zero. So there are finitely many, if there are finitely many of them, then there are finitely many non-zero products. So this is the first example of a superconformal algebra. Well, then I define special. Now, in the same way, we can consider divergence of a derivation. And special consists, subsuperalgebra consists of those with zero divergence. Then we could consider, you could just take a list of Cartan algebras and define analogs. Certain differential, they keep certain differential forms invariant, but I went different way. You know, if you have an associative commutative superalgebra, and notice that I don't need to define what is it. I already defined it for an arbitrary variety. It means that the Grassmann envelope of it is an associative commutative algebra. For example, Grassmann algebra is not commutative, but it is commutative superalgebra. And by the way, Lie superalgebra is not a Lie algebra. So suppose that we have an associative commutative superalgebra, and we define a bracket. Bracket, what is bracket? Bracket is a product, bilinear product. We call it Poisson bracket if it defines the structure of a Lie superalgebra on R. And if you fix one variable, then with respect to the other variable, it becomes a derivation. Like ordinary Poisson bracket. Those who studied mechanics know it. Well, and then it leads to, you know, this. Then we could consider this algebra of polynomials, various Poisson brackets, and get this series of Lie superalgebras. They are called of Hamiltonian type. But in order for it to be simple, you need at least two even variables. If you remember the formula for Poisson brackets, they involve two variables at least. And we have only one, t. So Hamiltonian type doesn't produce anything, any superconformal algebra. But then we can go further and define certain generalizations of Poisson brackets, the so-called contact bracket. So what's a contact bracket? It's a bracket which, again, defines the structure of a Lie superalgebra on R. But now, if you fix one variable, it's no longer a derivation, because every derivation kills the identity element. Easy exercise. Now, we don't kill this identity element. It's not zero. But this is a derivation. So it's the same, but on the second step. And if you want to differentiate, so to say, a product, you do it in this way. It's not product rule. So, well, if you take every derivation, every Poisson bracket is a contact bracket. But there are more non-trivial examples. For example, yeah, if you consider just polynomials, this vector field sort of formula is again contact bracket, but not Poisson. There is a much more complicated formula on this algebra. Well, you can see it. That's the advantage of using the screen and the text. Do you think I will be able to remember it if I use blackboard? Okay. So there are non-trivial examples. And if you take that non-trivial example, it defines a new superconformal algebra of type, it's called K, because it is an analog of Cartan type, of Cartan algebras of contact type. And by the way, all these superconformal algebras were known before. As old as they were introduced by physicists under different names. So the question is, how can we classify all superconformal algebras? And it sounds precisely in the same way as that original problem of Katz and Mathieu. The theorem of Katz and Mathieu classifies all Z-graded Lie algebras graded simple of polynomial growth. The only difference is that now we have superalgebras, and that now we are ready to agree not to polynomial growth, but to linear growth. And also they should contain Virasoro. But very close. And the original conjecture was that, well, that the algebras that I described so far are all examples, like in the theorem of Mathieu. But in 96, independently, Chang Katz and Grossman Leiters Shepechkina found a new conformal algebra, which Chang and Katz called CK6. CK is not Calvin Klein. It is Chang Katz. And since there are many graduate students here, it's a good kind of lesson for them. Chang and Katz published in Communications in Mathematical Physics, which is a very well-known journal. And Grossman, Leiters, Shepechkina published it in some Vietnamese journal. So nobody noticed it. And they also put it in archive, but in the section of high energy physics. So for a long time, everybody referred only to one paper, and this notation, became widely used. So the lesson is that publishing journals that people read and publish otherwise. So, in 2001, in a joint paper with Martinez, we sort of extended this construction now for an arbitrary associative commutative superalgebra with an even derivation. We could construct Chang-Katz algebra, and the original version was just if you apply this construction to Laurent polynomials with ordinary values. They were 8x8 matrices over the algebra of differential operators, the so-called Weyl algebra. Well, because in the original paper, Chang and Katz basically wrote a multiplication table. And then one had to check that this is a least superalgebra. Grossman, Leiters, Shepechkina found it as a subalgebra of, vector fields in a circle. And that was a third way. Well, the current conjecture is that now all superconformal algebras are what was expected originally, plus CK6. That was the only new superconformal algebra. And there are good reasons to believe that this is true. The reasons are, in 2001, in a joint paper with Katz and Martinez, we proved that we classified superconformal algebras, which have some Jordan superalgebras behind. I don't want to go into the definition, but that's a natural restriction, and they all turned out to be class K and CK6. And then there is another approach. So, superconformal algebra is a Z-graded algebra, where all homogeneous components have dimensions uniformly bounded from above. Let's be modest. Let us say that they are all equal, as in the basic examples. It means that in every homogeneous component, we can choose some basis. Say, D element if the dimension is D. And then a product, means Li, it's a degree. If you consider a product of two basic elements, the degree becomes I plus J. So it is a linear combination of these elements. And we have got the structural constants. If you fix P, Q, and R, it becomes a function on two integer variables, I and J. And let us make a strong assumption that we can find bases such that all these structural constant functions are polynomials in I and J. You may ask, you may say, it's a very strong assumption. Yes, it is. In all basic examples, this is the case. now this polynomiality condition can be expressed in another language. Let us consider, you see what happens at the beginning of the page. I took all basic elements with the same number, and z plays the role of a variable. This is a formal sum. It's called formal distribution. It doesn't have any meaning. It is just a compact way to write the string of elements, EIP. Now, this is a formal distribution. What can we do with them? We certainly, so a formal distribution is a formal power sum with coefficients from the algebra, and powers of z are positive and negative. We can certainly add them, no problem.